I believe in Yeshua HaMashiach. We will glorify the Lamb. We believe in Yeshua HaMashiach. We will worship the great I Am. How y'all doing today? It's a pleasure to have you in another Turtleside chat. Haven't had one of these in a while. Please don't forget to share this with all the serious students of the Word. I'm going to try to finish up today the teaching on Believer's Mikvah. The last time we were with you, by the way, we're coming to you live in another Turtleside chat. Let me get a little closer to you so you could love on me. Love on me, baby. We're coming to you live from one of the studios here. We have several studios in Goshen Mitzvah for our growing international outreach and video ministry. We saw in Acts, Maaseh Shlichim, which is a book of doctrine. It's not just a book of history or of transition. We learned it was a book of doctrine upon which the Hebraic roots of the faith can be established, overriding the dictates of man 325 years later at the Council of Nicaea. We see that Shimon Kefa, Peter, commanded mikvah to Beit Cornelia, the house of Cornelius, in Acts, Maaseh Shlichim 10:48. So it's a commandment. Now let's see where else we can find in the book of Acts, believers mikvah. All we have to do is fast forward to Maaseh Shlichim, Acts 16, and let's go in verse 14. We went from Beit Cornelia to Lydia, the beauty of Yah, Lydia. And we see in verse 14, a certain woman, I'm in Acts, Maaseh Shlichim 16, in another Turtleside chat school class. These are serious classes, and I only want serious students. The rest of you that are not serious, you know, go jump rope or go water skiing. You'll have more fun. He's such a mean shaliach. Oh, my gosh. And when he was immersed, go back to 14. A woman named Lydia, a seller of purple. Actually, it's a seller of the techelet, which is the purple dye, bluish purple dye used to make talits or talitim, plural, prayer shawls. So we see that Shaliach Shaul and Lydia had the same craft. And so that's one of the things that brought them together. But she used purple dye or techelet, and she was an Israelite from the city of Thyatira, probably from the 10 tribes of Beit Yosef. And she worshiped Yahuwah and listened to the apostle, to the Melo Hagoyim. Paul was not the apostle to the Gentiles. That is false. He was a true apostle, not a false apostle. He was a true shaliach to the Melo HaGoyim, or the seed of Ephraim, the 10 tribes, collectively called Ephraim or Israel or Joseph, that had become, according to Bereshit 49:18 and Romia chapter 11, the fullness of the nations. So was he an apostle to the nations? Yes and no. Specifically, to those who had become through assimilation the fullness of the nation. So she and her household had worshipped Yahuwah and listened to the Besorah, the good news that he brought. What is the good news? That the one that you're reading about every day, every Shabbat, has come. So now we don't study the word. We don't preach the good news just to know the writings of the Creator, but to actually know the Creator, to know the author. See, in the Tanakh, we were married to the instructions. The instructions are still for today. But now, through the Brit Chadashah written in our heart desires and has found a relationship, back and forth, give and take, talking, communication, an open relationship that the world doesn't even know can exist. And then through the preaching of the good news, we get to know we're married to the author. Okay, people always ask, what is one of the main differences between Tanakh and Brit Chadashah, New Covenant and First Covenant? The answer is we're not married to the letter, we're married to the author. See, all of us are married. We're his wives. And he loves us. He in us, we in him. It's a term of very heavy sexual penetration and intimacy, not in a dirty sense, but in a metaphoric sense that fits with the whole picture of the Song of Solomon or Shir HaShirim. There are many songs of love, but the song between the Mashiach and his ladies, that's us, his faithful brides, is the Shir HaShirim, or the song above all songs, that we, the bride, sing to the Melech HaMelechim, or the King of all kings, and to us is given the Shir HaShirim, see? Song of all songs, or above all songs, even as Yeshua has the Shem HaShamim, or the name, or Shem Allah Shemot, the name over other names, okay? And she asked Shaul and his traveling companions, I believe it was Silas, if you have judged me to be faithful to Yahuwah, come into my bayit, come into my home, and stay there. And she urged us to come visit and stay in her home. And it came to pass as we went to, where were we here? She believed. Let's go back to the end of verse 14. She received the thing spoken by Shaul, which is the Besorah. 15. Now when she was first immersed with her family, her entire mishpacha, she asked us, saying, please stay in the house. And she urged us to do that. And then verse 16, they stayed with Lydia. And then next Shabbat, they celebrated Shabbat together. So we see Shaliach Shaul was a commandment keeper. He was a Torah commandment keeper. They messed up his image in the Council of Nicaea, just like they messed up the image of Mashiach. Forget about the way Paul has been presented to us today. That is not the original Paul. We're so concerned about finding the original Yeshua, and the rabbi who was righteous and kept Torah and was the Malki Tzedek, or the king of righteousness, or the king of everything that is right about Yahuwah and wrong about us. But no one is very interested in finding the original Paul. The original Paul is here. He mikvahs Lydia as a commandment. It's a mitzvah. The commandment is found in Matthew 28, 18 through 20, where Yeshua commands all his believers to be mikvahed into his name. So if you're coming out of the church system where you were mikvahed in Jehus's name, or Jesus, you need to be re-mikvahed. It's a rhetorical question. You're now an Israelite. You're now a follower. You're now a Torah keeper. You're now a Shabbat keeper. Of course, you need to come under a covering, under a spiritual Abba that he has assigned to you, and to be mikvahed afresh in your new walk as a child of the covenant, no longer married to the letter or to a false religious doctrine of grace alone, but to the author. So watch the order. She was mikvahed, then he went into her house to stay and stayed until next Shabbat. So we see Kepha mikvahed Cornelius, Paul mikvahed Lydia, you see? And then later on, and we see Shaul and Shelah, Silas, in the Philippian jail, and they sang praises to Yahuwah. And at midnight, the gates swung open, and they were free to go. They spoke the word of Yahuwah, Acts 16:32, to the Philippian jailer. And the keeper of the prison says that you can go in shalom, etc., etc. But look at verse 33. And he took in the same hour of the night and washed their stripes. And the Philippian jailer was immersed. Look at verse 33. Maaseh Shel Yochim 16:33. The Philippian jailer was immersed, he and his mishpacha, right away. You see? And then 34, when he had brought them into his house, he took care of him. They came and pleaded with them to leave the prison. And then they went from prison into the house of Lydia. We read about her earlier, verse 40, Acts 16:40. And they were comforted there, probably celebrating another Shabbat or waiting for the next Shabbat to roll around. So we see right here in Acts 16 that Shaul, when the Philippian jailer had confessed his sins, they mikvahed him as well. Him and his entire mishpacha were mikvahed in the name of Yeshua. Because we know, we learned earlier last time, it is only in the name of Yeshua. Now, we go to Acts 18 in verse 8, and it said, Crispus, the rabbi of the synagogue, believed in Yeshua. Notice, okay, they had gone, of course, to Corinth. They went from Athens to Corinth. And among the lost sheep of the house of Israel in Corinth, there came probably a somewhat Hellenized rabbi named Crispus. It says in verse 8 of Maaseh Shlichim 18, Crispus was the rabbi of that of a local synagogue in Corinth, and he believed on Yeshua. We don't believe in Yeshua. We don't believe that nonsense anymore. We believe on him. Our hope, our dreams, our aspirations, our health, our finances. Man, you know and I know it's all on him. So don't be like the world and devils. Oh, I believe in Yeshua. Now let's go fornicate and sin and let's get drunk and let's do drugs. No, we believe on him. See? We trust him. We trust him with our life the same way we have no choice. The same way he trusts us because we accepted his death, Yeshua. So now we can trust him with our life. See? Okay, now the rabbi believed on Yeshua with all his bayit, and many other Corinthians heard with the rabbi, probably once the rabbi had been converted to Yeshua. And the rabbi and many other Corinthians believed and were mikvahed, immersed. Okay? And then Yahuwah says, keep doing the besorah, and keep mikvahing them, obeying the commandment to enter believers' baptism and stay here for a long time because I have many, many people for you to reach here in that in this city. Then we go to Acts 19 and we see a group of people who were prepared to receive Yeshua and the Ruach. But in Acts 19, verse 3, Shaul said to them, let me ask you a question. Have you received believers' mikvah? Believers' mikvah means in the authority and name, in the name of Yeshua. So to me, any mikvah that is not done according to the commandments found in the book of Acts, which is not just a transitional historical book, it is a book for doctrine according to 2 Timothy 3, 15 and 16. It is profitable for doctrine. And the reason it's profitable for doctrine, it will show you how the early Nazarene Israelite communities lived until Constantine and the Council of Nicaea overturned and remade Yeshua into Jesus and remade Shaliach Shaul into Paul the Apostle, who came to convert Jews rather than fulfill his mission as the apostle to the, not the nations, but the melo hagoyim, or the fullness of the nations, i.e. the seed of Jacob through Joseph and his son Ephraim. Collectively, the 10 tribes of the northern kingdom became known as Ephraim. So don't get confused. It's not one tribe that Paul was sent to. It was to all 10 tribes lost in the diaspora, which is why he went every Shabbat in the synagogue looking and to share and to teach and to preach the lost sheep of the house of Israel. They said, we were this group here. While Apollos was at Antioch, Shaul came to Ephesus, Asia Minor, Ephesus. And they said, we were not mikvahed into Yeshua, but into Yochanan HaMadbil, meaning that was the mikvah to prepare us for the declaration of righteousness. Is there someone here that can tell me how to be a king of righteousness like my older brother Yeshua, the Melech Tzadik, or the king of right? And they said, we were only mikvahed in preparation for the king, the mikvah of preparation, but not believers. Then Shaul said, Yochanan HaMadbil immersed with mikvah of teshuvah, repentance to the people, that they should believe on him, Yeshua, who should come after him, that is the anointed one, Yeshua. Acts 19:4. When they heard that the promised one, that the mikvah of preparation or righteousness to make them, to show that they're willing to turn. See, the mikvah of John was to separate a people from the Prushim, the Tzadukim, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians, whoever, to separate a people, to prepare that people for the coming of Yeshua, according to Isaiah chapter 40. See, he's a voice in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, who's coming to save you. But so if you were not prepared, you were not ready to be saved. So they were prepared, this group in Ephesus, but they had only been mikvahed into the baptism, the mikvah of preparation. And Yeshua was declared to them by Shaliach Shaul. And he said, when they heard the good news that the Messiah, the Holy One of Israel, Yeshua HaNotzri, had come, they were, look at verse 5, Acts 19:5, they were immersed by Mayim, water, in the name of the Master Yeshua. No, notice, nowhere do we see Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. That's a bunch of nonsense. The only place that appears is Matthew 28:18-20, where the translators doctored with the text. But in the Aramaic Peshitta, it says they were mikvahed. Yeshua commanded, that's a Torah command. You can find many Torah commands in the New Testament. Be mikvahed in my name. And nowhere in the book of Acts or anywhere else, in any of the writings of the Brit Chadasha, the Renewed Covenant, do you ever see any kind of mikvot or tevilot done other than in the name of Yeshua? So if there are 20-30 scriptures confirming that, and there's only one scripture that seems to contradict that or is confusing, we are to ignore the one that doesn't sound right and contradicts the other 15 or 20. We go with the overwhelming proof of the evidence, the weight of evidence. So they were immersed in the name of the Master Yeshua, and then as soon as they were immersed, Shaul laid hands on them, verse 6, and they received the Ruach HaKadosh, the set-apart spirit, which came upon them, and they spoke with other tongues and prophesied, and the men were about 12. So 12 men, each for probably one of the 12 tribes of Israel. See? Showing to us in Acts 19, there were these 12 men who were mikvahed into Yochanan HaMadbil, but through the preaching to the Melo HaGoyim, Genesis 48:19, they entered as full citizens, not just prepared citizens, but full citizens that had passed the test of believing on Yeshua. And obviously, if you believe on Yeshua, you're only going to be mikvahed into his name. So if you were mikvahed into the name of the Father and the Son and the... Is that how you do it? I don't even know how you do it. I don't know if they do this or this or whatever. I don't want to know. That means you need to be re-mikvahed, of course. This should not even... among many believers, be a frequently asked question. If I was mikvahed in the name of a ghost, I didn't know that there are any holy ghosts. I know there were some not friendly ghosts. I know there were some demonic ghosts. But I never heard of friendly ghosts. The only one was a cartoon. And that was not real. Some of you may remember that cartoon. Casper, the friendly ghost. So if you've been mikvahed in the name of the Father, Son, and Ghost, you might as well go and get mikvahed in the name of Casper. Are you ready to be mikvahed? Are you ready to be mikvahed in the name of? You know, I'm just painting your toenails. That's right. I'm just painting your toenails. I'm pulling your leg. Okay, that's Tov. So that is es claro, it's clear. Now let's see what we can find in Acts 22. In Maaseh Shlichim 22, we see Shaliach Shaul addressing the people of Israel after he has been arrested in the temple. He recites a little bit of his background, how he became a follower of the way after he had been a persecutor of the way, binding and putting people into prison. And he says in verse 16, that once he had received his sight, spiritual sight, that, and he also had received physical blindness, he needed to have that physical blindness removed because Yahuwah allowed him to be physically blind so the persecution would stop. Once he was spiritually seen, then Yahuwah would order a, would command a mikvah for him to remove physical blindness. So we see that at times, a water immersion in the name of Yeshua following the Torah commandment to be mikvah can also bring healing. And he tells, after his arrest in the temple, in Maaseh Shlichim 22:16, he says, Hanania, or Ananias, which literally means in Hebrew, the grace of Yah, Hanania, the grace of Yah had removed his spiritual blindness, and so now he sees that the Messiah has come. He doesn't have to wait anymore. Just like my Jewish people are blind because they still think they have to wait for the Messiah. They don't see the fact that clearly that he has come. So they also need that kind of blindness removed. And Hananiah says, do not delay. Arise, see, don't delay. That's a commandment. Not only is mikvah a commandment, whether you, if you've been mikvah incorrectly in the Father, Son, and Ghost, or if you've been mikvah in the church system, Jesus, Yeshua, anti-Torah, eat pig, eat lobster, do whatever you want, the Aleister Crowley method of following Jesus, do what thou will. You know that demonic teacher, Aleister Crowley, just do what thou will, ba, 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 ba. And in a sense, the Christian church has been drinking that same demonic wine. They're victims. I love the people, but the system has victimized them. So they're drinking the same demonic wine of Aleister Crowley, the chief demonist and Satanist, do what thou wilt. Do not do what thou wilt. Do what the Master Yahuwah wants you to do, because now you believe on him, and he's willing to come into you and upon you because you have come into him. You see? So, why do you delay? Arise and be immersed in the name of Yeshua, washing away your sins, calling on the name of Yeshua or Yahuwah. See? There's no Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. So Paul himself was mikvah in the name that he in turn taught the Melo HaGayim, Corinth and Ephesus, to be mikvah, which is in the name of Yeshua. Okay? Then in Hebrews 6:4, we see that mikvah is a taste of what Yahuwah has up the road for you. In Hebrews 10:4. I'm sorry, Hebrews 6:4. So the beginning of your abundant life as a believer commences with believer's mikvah. Yes, when you get saved, but if you get saved and you're immediately disobedient, then how are you going to be a student? How are you going to be a Talmid or a Talmidah? So as soon as you believe, immediately, just like Hananiah and Shaul, immediately you must obey the Torah command of Matthew 28:18-20, directly from the mouth of Yeshua, Boca de Yeshua, to be mikvah. And if you're delaying and you're delaying and you're delaying and you haven't been a mikvah according to scripture, then you're not going to taste of the other things that Yahuwah has tasted, has prepared for you. So that journey in Yeshua starts off with trust on Yeshua and what is required. Please underline the word required as your first act of obedience, your first test. Not temptation, because Yahuwah does not tempt any man, neither is he himself tempted. So we know that Yeshua was Yahuwah, and when he was tested in the wilderness, he was not tempted to sin, but he was in all points tested. Because his brother Yaakov says in the book of James that Yahuwah is not tempted and cannot be tempted. He's not allured by the things you and I are allured by, the forbidden things, the dark things, the secret things, the mystical things. We are allured by those things, you see. Yeshua was not allured by them. So what happened to him, he was tested, because we know he was Yud-Heh, Vav-Heh, the word of Yahuwah, come in the flesh. He looked like a man, acted like a man, spoke like a man, but he was not a man from the dust. He did not have a sinful dust nature. He was the master from heaven. Therefore, he was not a human being. That is poppycock. You need to grow up. You need to work through that in your mind so you will understand you do not worship a man. Therefore, that person that was killed on Calvary was not a human being, which would violate Torah. Because the Jews say, oh, we're not going to accept Yeshua because you want us to accept that the human being was sacrificed for sins. And the Torah makes it clear that not only does Yahuwah not believe or accept human sacrifice, that human sacrifice never even entered into his mind. So therefore, Yahuwah had a fine line. He had to play a fine line. He had to appear as a man. He had to be tested as a man. He had to take on flesh like Miriam and Yosef, his step-parents. They were actually both his step-parents. You've been taught that Joseph was his, Mary didn't give her egg. If she would have given her egg, he would have come to us with a dust nature, perishable and mortal. Think it through. Go online and study my teachings on the whole wheat unleavened bread. Order the book, Our Last Day's Meal. He had two step-parents, making him truly the son of Yah and the son of his mother, the Ruach HaKadosh. The Ruach HaKadosh impregnated Miriam without an egg. The Ruach HaKadosh was his mother, and Abba Yahuwah was his father. Because if either one had contributed a sperm or an egg, he's a human sacrifice breaking Torah. And we know that the true Messiah has to come and completely reveal Torah in its intended fullness without violating it. So we see that in Hebrews 6:4. Mikvah is the beginning of your journey and all of your enlightenment. We see that confirmed in Hebrews 10:32. Hebrews 10:32. Remember the former days after you were immersed in mikvah. You endured great fighting and suffering over your new faith. See? When you first got saved, the first thing you did was you were mikvah. That may have been the first thing you did. But you didn't do it as a returning Israelite. Lunch water. Not holy water, but lunch water. Baruch Hashem Yahuwah. Then Rav Shaul says in Romans 6:3, don't you know that as many of us as obeyed the commandment and were mikvah in Yeshua's name. Look at that. It's right there in the Pauline epistles. Romans, so how did Shaul do his mikvah? According to Torah. In the name of Yeshua, not the name of the Father and the Son and Casper the friendly ghost. He says, don't you know that as many of you that were mikvah, immersed into the name of Yeshua, have been immersed into his death, and as we were buried with him by mikvah into death, meaning our own life, like Messiah, who was raised from the dead by the Tiferet of Abba, we also should come out of the water of mikvah, ready to dedicate our new life to a new halacha, a new way to walk, and a new life, and a new chayim. The dead man goes into the water, stays in the water, and out of the water comes someone who's ready to obey him. Because he said in Yochanan 14:15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. Then we go to 1 Corinthians 1:13, and Paul says this, is Mashiach divided? Was Shaul crucified for you? You're not my followers, you're his. Or were you immersed in the name of of Shaul? Were you immersed in the name of Crispus? Were you immersed in the name of Gaius? Verse 15, no one should say that I am immersed in my own name. Pardon me, you see that? He understood that we were not to immerse in any or under any other name. Verse 15, no one should say about Paul or any of the Shliachim that they immersed in their name or they came up with a religious man-created formula in which to do mikvah. He says, I was sent not to mikvah, but to preach so that you would be mikvahed in the name of Yeshua. That's the command. That's the mitzvah for Jew and non-Jew alike. See that? Go back. I want you to see this clearly. Open your Bibles. Stop being so stoic. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 15, chapter 1. No one should say that I immersed into my own name or my own theology or my own ideology or my own way of thinking. I didn't come to mikvah you in my own formula to make you a Christian disciple of the Apostle Paul. I came to preach the good news and then forbid mikvah under any other authority, whether it's Crispus, Gaius, or Apollos, or even my own authority. I have no choice but to mikvah you the way Hananiah in Damascus, the way Hananiah, the grace of Yah, visited me and mikvahed me. So I don't know if this is going to be the last on this series. There might be a little bit more to cover. I'll decide, and you'll be the first to know if we're going to do more parts to this wonderful Turtle Side Chat series. Those of you who were with us last night live on television, wow, I know you felt the Ruach. I mean, when we got off the air, we had fun. Potato latkes, applesauce, laughing, good fellowship. The children were playing dreidel and got chocolate gelt, chocolate money. We had a ball. We're going to have another Hanukkah celebration on Shabbat. And then this coming Tuesday is Chodesh number 10, the 10th new month. We don't follow the new moon because the moon is not a light. The Jews never follow the light of the moon because there is no light to the moon. It is a reflector of light. That practice began when Nehemiah and Ezra died after the Babylonian captivity and the Jewish people went into apostasy. So you'll want to be with us next Tuesday. And then next Wednesday, I have decided, we had so much fun last night, I've decided to make next Wednesday, the eighth day of the biblical Hanukkah, a pizza party right here for the community. So from all of us here at Goshen Mitzvah, we bid you adieu, au revoir, and shalom. We'll see you, Yah willing, on Shabbat, 12 o'clock, live for an in-depth message from the book of Zechariah. Shalom.